Well, good morning, everyone. Thank you for having me here. It truly is an honor to be here speaking on behalf of my father, Andrew Brunson. And as I'm sure y'all could imagine, he'd much rather be here himself, but that's not an option. I am standing here. So I've been told that you all have some updates on what my dad is going through. He's currently going through the trial process with his next trial date on July 18. But I want to go back to the start of this whole ordeal for my family and tell you what it was like, what the last year and a half has been like for my family, but also I want to share how we've seen the Lord at work and what he's been teaching our family through this whole ordeal. So October 7, 2016, more than a year and a half ago, is the day that my parents were called into the police station. This was my older brother's 21st birthday, by the way, and he never got that birthday call. Because my parents were called in, and they thought they were going to be asked some questions for their permanent residence permit application, because they wanted to continue working in Turkey long term. What they were not expecting is to be told that they had been deemed a threat to national security and that they were going to be deported. This all happened so quickly that they were barely able to tell a few family members what was going on before their phones were taken away and they were taken into custody. I didn't find out until a few days after the fact, when my aunt had to call me and ask me if I had an update. And the next 2.5 weeks were absolutely terrifying. My brothers and I had no update. We didn't know why they were taken. We didn't know what was happening. We didn't know how they were being treated, how they were being kept. It was really a scary time when we had absolutely no information and no way to get that information. All we knew is that something was very, very wrong. So when my mom was released 2.5 weeks in, it was a relief to get some news and to understand what was starting to happen. But at the same time, that conversation I had with her was heartbreaking. She had just said goodbye to my dad and didn't know when she'd see him again. And we embarked on this long journey of uncertainty and not knowing when God is going to orchestrate my dad's release. But it's been a tough year. As Richard alluded, we've had some big family milestones. I got married, I graduated college. We've also had some unfortunate events in the family. My grandfather on my mom's side passed away this past January, and my mom was unable to be there, which was very difficult. So we have sacrificed as a family, and in each one of my dad's letters to his kids, he always says his greatest desire is to be reunited with us, with his family. But despite the difficulty and the sacrifices that we've had to make, we have seen God at work, and we've seen him working through the situation and teaching us. So I want to share some of that with you. For myself, I can say that I've really started to lean into the concept of God's sovereignty. I have taken so much comfort in knowing that God is in control, that he has a plan, that he will use this to his glory regardless of what the outcome is. And it's really encouraging to know that God is so powerful, so much more powerful than world powers and leaders and nations. It's really crazy to realize that for me. And I've taken a lot of comfort in that. I can also say that through the last year watching my parents, I've realized how blessed I am to have them as my example in life, in marriage and parenting and ministry and following God. It's really no small thing to have people in my life who have displayed such a great example of following God, whatever the cost, whatever the sacrifice, and in the face of persecution and suffering, being strong and remaining faithful to the Lord and putting on a good testimony. I'm really blessed to have that. I can say another thing that we've really seen come out of this is with a lot of attention being given to my dad, we've seen so many believers from all over the world starting to focus in on Turkey and pray for the Turkish church, which is absolutely huge. So many people wouldn't be praying if it weren't for my dad's situation. And along those lines, back in the fall, there were some believers who had been praying for a song, praying that the Lord would give a song to the Turkish church to sing in times of persecution. And at the same time, the Lord was laying on my dad's heart the desire to write his song, "You Are Worthy of It All." And it was amazing to see how God orchestrated that timing with no one being aware of what was going on. We've also seen through this the power of prayer. Countless people who have never met my dad, don't know the family, but people who are faithfully praying every day for his release and for God to sustain him. It's been very encouraging, and we really have seen God come through and hold my dad up and sustain him in this difficult time. And we've also been seeing my dad change. We've been seeing him learn and grow through this experience. At the start, it was very difficult. It was a trying time. He was trying to make sense of what was happening. Where is God in this? This doesn't make sense to me, was his thought process. But we've really seen that as things have progressed, he's really come to say, I can't see God working from where I am at this point, but I am still going to faithfully declare God, and I'm going to try to bring glory to him. I'm going to submit my will. I'm going to obey, and in everything, just endure to the end and trust and declare in God's goodness. It's been a very encouraging example for me to have to see my dad doing that in this time. And just as an example, one of the ways that he has made it a point to submit to the Lord and to obey is in rejoicing. Now, it's difficult to rejoice and have joy in a difficult situation, especially in, you know, controlling your emotions. But what he has chosen to do is to rejoice in an act. So every single day, he'll be out in the courtyard in the prison, surrounded by concrete walls. And my dad is a fairly reserved person, doesn't do silly things in public, but he will dance with no music. He dances before the Lord as David danced, as an act of rejoicing and obedience. I get a bit of a kick out of that mental image of my dad, but it's it's encouraging to see him finding little ways that he can obey the Lord and submit. And through this time, he started to do a lot better. In the last few weeks especially, he's much more at peace. And he's decided to take this opportunity to write to us kids and share what's happening, his struggles, but also how he's growing, what he's learning, and what he wants to pass on to us kids. And I felt that since he can't be here in person, I should read from just a couple of his letters to give you a glimpse into what he's experiencing and what he's sharing with us. So the first letter reads, Jesus shows the way to victory, what he wants from me and from all of us. I'm attempting to follow his example. First, I declare with my will that I will submit to him. I'm kept here by force, but I can choose to submit with my will, even though my emotions are severely distressed and not at all wanting to submit. I'm trying to be faithful even when overwhelmed with fear, faithful to declare God's character even when I don't understand. I ask you to pray for me in this, to be faithful to the end. Second, I have prayed that God glorify his name. This is a surrender, and I hope he will glorify his name and that he will do it at least in part by saving me. Third, I sing my song every night. I pray this added prayer each night. Father God, I ask that you pour out on me the courage and strength, the endurance, perseverance, and steadfastness of Jesus. I declare God's character and pray that he use this time to work deeply in my life. I want to stand before God at the end of my life without regrets. I want to be faithful, to keep my heart on him, to submit, to declare his character, to worship him, and to not be conquered by fear. I have fought many battles psychologically, emotionally, spiritually, and physically here. I have lost many times. But every time I sing my song is a victory. Every time I am pressed by fear, and in the midst of that fear, I turn to Jesus is a victory. So I share honestly. I deal with fear every day. I deal with suffering, with my loneliness, isolation, and the agony of separation from my beloved family. But I want to endure. And fourth, where else can I go? To whom can I entrust my future and my life other than God? And his second letter, which is the most recent one, just from May, is as follows. With good reason, we honor those who are martyred for the sake of Jesus. The actual meaning of martyr is one who bears witness or testimony. And so it is applied to one who, because of his faith, bears witness through sacrificing his life. The death of the believer on account of Jesus is a public testimony to the person's faith and gospel, and that Jesus is worthy of such sacrifice. I in no way want to diminish the meaning of this word as we now use it, to cheapen it by making it common and comparing one who dies for his faith to one who bears witness by simply identifying as a Christian. However, what has come to mind is that there are living martyrs. I would describe them as people who have been singled out because of their faith in Jesus and persecuted for this faith, especially so if done in a public context. The result is that the believer suffers, perhaps to the extent of Matthew 5, 11 through 12, where they are despised, reviled, looked down on, lies are told about them, or they are persecuted financially and physically, or they may become the object of official repression, including imprisonment. Some who are living martyrs eventually end up losing their lives. So many believers died in prison in China and the Soviet Union. They were first living martyrs and then martyrs in the traditional use of the word. A living martyr is one who continues to bear witness in the face of this persecution, who is faithful, does not deny Jesus, and continues to proclaim as possible, "I belong to Jesus, he is my king. He has not deserted me, and I by his grace will not desert him, nor will I be ashamed." There are many circumstances where it is much more difficult to be a living martyr than to die for Jesus. For the martyr, on dying, immediately goes to Jesus' presence. But the living martyr can live with disgrace, physical pain, and imprisonment. I write this because I have been thrust into a situation I would not have thought possible, where I am reviled, lied about, despised publicly, and have been imprisoned in circumstances that have taken me far beyond what I can endure if not for God's hidden grace. I have been made a public spectacle. So I have been singled out for persecution because of my faith, and it is known that I'm a Christian. And so I'm in the position of being a living martyr. I do not take this on as a title. I am not awarding myself a name or honor. I am describing, rather, the responsibility that has been thrust upon me. I don't know how long or in what way this terrible trial will end. And I need to stand without shame and faithfully bear the suffering and pain thrust upon me and be a living witness for Jesus. I do not feel strong. I'm afraid that I will be declared guilty in the court and given a long sentence. But I am aware that I have a responsibility, an opportunity to suffer publicly for Jesus. And so I am trying to strengthen myself to be a living martyr who will be faithful and not ashamed at the end for having faltered. I ask the Lord to spare you, my dear children, from persecution. I hope, as Paul did in Colossians 2, that in some way my suffering will keep you from suffering. But we are also told by Paul that all who live godly lives will be persecuted to some degree. And so I hope to be a good example to you, even in my great weakness. I hope that you will take on the mentality of a living martyr, even if you are never placed in such a situation. Settle it in your hearts now, asking God to pour out grace upon you, that you will stand for Jesus whatever the circumstances or consequences. If God places you in the position to be a living martyr, then may it be clear how to do this faithfully. I have to say I'm grateful for a father who, in spite of his suffering and the persecution he's enduring, takes time to write to his children and to share what God is showing him and to encourage us and to try to push us kids in a good direction. It really is a blessing. And when my dad heard that I would be speaking, he wanted to send a special message to the EPC church. He is so grateful for all of the prayer and all of the support that you have provided. So I want to close by sharing his direct message to you. My brothers and sisters at the EPC, I am so grateful to you for standing with us during this difficult time, for praying for us. I know a number of people have fasted, and I thank you for doing this. It's a great blessing to us to be a part of the EPC family. I pray every day to be faithful to the end. And it is my desire to show the great worth of Jesus Christ by being willing to suffer for him. And I ask that you pray for me in this, that I will be faithful to the end. I hope that next year I will be able to thank all of you in person rather than through my beautiful daughter. But again, thank you for standing with us. Your brother, Andrew. Thank you all.
August the 24th, 2017, ushered in an especially difficult time for Jacqueline's dad. That day, he appeared in court via video from his prison. The The prosecutor accused Andrew of attempting to overthrow the government and of subverting the Constitution. Preposterous charges. From September the 10th to the 13th, he wrote the lyrics and the music to Worthy of My All. Many of our churches and presbyteries have been singing Andrew's song in 2018. As we are led by our hope musicians, let's stand and sing Andrew's song, Worthy of My All.
To be found worthy to stand here on that day with no regrets left undone, to hear you say, well done, my faithful friend, you were certain, Jesus, my sure prize I'm running for, Jesus, my joy, you're the prize I'm running for. You are worthy, worthy of my praise. You are worthy, worthy of my all. What can I give to the Son of God who gave